Afternoon. The first item of business today is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio this afternoon is Deputy First Minister Responsibilities, Economy and Gaelic. I remind members that questions 1 and 7 are grouped together and that I'll take any supplementaries on these questions after both have been answered. And otherwise, of course, members who wish to request a supplementary question should press their request to speak buttons during the relevant question. At question number 1, I call Alec Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether its decision not to make survivors of abuse at Ferneithy House eligible for Scotland's redress scheme was due to budgetary pressures.
Deputy First Minister.
No, and I want to push back very robustly on any suggestion that it was. This decision was not made lightly. The existing eligibility criteria reflect the core purpose of Scotland's redress scheme, as approved by Parliament, which was designed primarily for those vulnerable children in long-term care, often isolated with limited or no contact with their families. Inquiries conducted by an independent researcher indicate that this was not the position of Ferneithy survivors, although it in no way diminishes the abhorrent experiences of those survivors. I will meet with members of the Ferneithy Survivors Group next week to discuss their concerns directly.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm grateful for that reply. Presiding Officer, the abuse that the Ferneithy women endured as children is utterly, utterly appalling. Anyone who has met with them can't help but feel a sense of fury at what they suffered and an admiration at their brave plight and fight for justice. But now they face a further injustice of being excluded from a scheme which exists to compensate people like them who were abused in care as children. Why? Fundamentally, because they just weren't abused for long enough. Last year, John Swinney said he believed, and I quote, it was possible for Ferneithy survivors to be successful in applying under the redress scheme, but this position has clearly changed. Does the Deputy First Minister recognise that by excluding the women from the redress scheme, she has not just denied them access to that compensation, but denied official recognition by the state and ultimately their quest for justice?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I refute that characterisation of the decision completely. I am also deeply sorry to hear what Ferneithy survivors had to endure as children, the impact that abuse has had on their lives and the abhorrent experiences that they had. And I commend their courage in sharing those experiences. These are extremely weighty and difficult matters which we have tried to balance carefully. As I already said to the members, I will meet with Ferneithy Survivors Group and we will work to see what else can be done to support those survivors.
And I call it question 7, Sue Webber.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government for what reason it decided that survivors of abuse at Ferneithy House should not be eligible to access Scotland's redress scheme.
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I determined not to amend the eligibility criteria of Scotland's redress scheme after deep and careful consideration, because I believe that it continues to reflect the core purpose, which was approved by Parliament following a public consultation, and the views of survivors, which is paramount. That core eligibility criteria was to provide redress for vulnerable children in long-term care, often isolated, limited or no contact with their families. Decisions on individual applications are rightfully a matter for Redress Scotland.
Sue Webber.
Survivors at Ferneithy House say they are shocked, disgusted and angry. The Citizen Participation in Public's Petitions Committee said in unanimous view was that the Ferneithy survivors should be included in the scheme. And on the 12th of January 2023, then Deputy First Minister John Swinney stated to my committee, I do not believe that as things stand, there is an inherent impediment to applications to the redress scheme coming forward from people who spent time at Ferneithy. To put it slightly more bluntly, I reject the idea that the scheme is not for Ferneithy survivors. I think that it's possible for Ferneithy survivors to be successful in applying under the scheme. So what's changed, Deputy First Minister? And with the women who are now started a billboard campaign in their fight for compensation, what will you say to them when you meet them later this week?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, what I will say to them is quite rightly to be said to them first, because they are the ones who have come forward and encouraged, shared their experiences, and they have had to endure abhorrent abuse. As the member will know, the previous Deputy First Minister met with representatives of the Ferneithy Survivors Group to discuss the findings of the independent research report that was commissioned to consider these matters quite directly. And while in no way diminishing the experiences of those survivors, it was recognised during the passage of the original legislation that eligibility was to reflect those in long-term care with limited or no contact with their families. But as I said, Presiding Officer, I will meet with the Ferneithy Survivors Group and I look forward to engaging directly with them.
A supplementary, Jackson Carlow.
The Deputy First Minister will know the particular interests of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee. We've taken extensive evidence over many years, in fact, from the Ferneithy survivors. We've obviously received the Deputy First Minister's letter. We will still have an opportunity to consider it formally, but I can say that informally today, the committee is unanimously still of the view, as we expressed it, that these women are entitled to compensation. We are bitterly disappointed. So I should serve notice to the Deputy First Minister that the committee will seek debating time in the chamber to give this chamber the opportunity to express its view as to whether or not the government should change its position.
Deputy First Minister.
Well, can I first of all commend the committee, the Petitions Committee, for the way in which they have taken evidence on this matter in a compassionate, caring but robust manner, which is totally in keeping with the weighty matters that are under discussion. I am obviously willing to engage with the committee as is appropriate, including engaging with Parliament if it comes to that. These are not matters that I have concluded lightly. I have engaged extensively with survivors that are involved with the redress scheme, as I know the convener will have as well. And to conclude, Presiding Officer, I will of course engage directly with the survivors in the coming days.
And supplementary, Colin Smith.
Presiding Officer, these were wee girls, hundreds, maybe even thousands, sent to Ferneithy by the state, abused at the hands of the state, physically, mentally and in some cases sexually. Yet the state, this government, Glasgow City Council, are utterly failing to take any responsibility. So if the Deputy First Minister doesn't believe extending the redress scheme is the way for the state to take responsibility, then what does she think is the way? Now, when I and the Ferneithy survivors meet with the Deputy First Minister next week, some of the women won't be there because they've died since they were abused. How much longer did these survivors have to wait?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, can I say up front in my answer that having read of some of the experiences, having listened carefully to the experiences that have been shared, I am in absolutely no doubt about the appalling and disgraceful and disgusting abuse that has been suffered by those individuals. And that is why it is so important that we get this right, that we navigate the issues, recognising the debate when this legislation was first passed, the views of survivors then. And I do look forward to meeting with Colin Smith and the survivors next week. But the decision that the government has come to does not in any way diminish the experiences suffered by those at Ferneithy.
Question number two, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with UK government counterparts regarding future plans for the Shared Prosperity and Levelling Up Funds.
Deputy First Minister.
Well, we're in regular contact with the UK Government on a range of issues, including the Shared Prosperity and Levelling Up Funds. We continue to seek clarity on the future of those programmes, which I don't have as yet.
Willie Coffey.
Can I thank the Deputy First Minister for that answer? Let's remember, Presiding Officer, that these funds emerged as a replacement for European funding. for which we had full engagement with and scrutiny of. But with these, there was none of that, no attempt to even engage with our local councils on whether they shared the priorities set for them by the last UK government. Is there any hope that the Labour government will reverse that nonsense and refocus the policy intention of these funds so that what is ultimately delivered for local people reflects local needs and priorities, and that this Parliament will have a role in scrutinising the effectiveness of how this public money is spent?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I am encouraged by the Labour Party's manifesto commitment to restore decision-making over the allocation of structural funds to the devolved nations. And so, taking them at their word, I therefore expect to work with the UK Government in the design and implementation of any future funds and only await the invitation to do so.
Supplementary, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I just say how much I welcome the newfound enthusiasm on the SNP benches for the shared prosperity and levelling up funds? I don't remember hearing that in the recent past, but it's good to know that they've been welcomed. I wonder if the Deputy First Minister would agree with me that many communities across Scotland benefited from these funds, and we all want to see them continue.
Deputy First Minister.
They used to benefit from all the funds that we got from the European Union as well, which I think they had more power over, control over and more say in the allocation of. So I think my newfound enthusiasm is in the hope that the decisions might be less politicised than they were under the regime operated by Murdo Fraser's colleagues.
Supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. There's been deep frustration in Glasgow in recent months due to the closure of Regeneration and Capital Grant Fund at a Scottish Government level, but also the suspension of funds like the Community Ownership Fund at UK Government level. So would the Deputy First Minister please look to engage rapidly with the Treasury and our colleagues in Government to ensure that when the budget is forthcoming in October, we can rapidly reopen those funds if capital funding is unlocked?
Deputy First Minister.
The Member can rest assured that my colleague, the Finance Secretary, is engaging extensively with the UK Government in order to ensure that there is adequate capital in order to reopen those funds. Unfortunately, I think that we are not feeling overly optimistic considering the words of the Prime Minister about things getting worse before they get better and the Chancellor's comments that this may be the hardest budget. And therefore, we will keep up our engagement, but it would be great if all members in this chamber also recognise the fact that if there is more capital at source, we can do more.
And supplementary, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I recently met with STEP in my constituency, who raised the issue of a lack of clarity on the future of the Shared Prosperity Fund and its impact on investment. Does the Deputy First Minister share these concerns?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I completely recognise the uncertainty that organisations such as STEP are facing regarding the future of the Shared Prosperity Fund. We need clarity from the UK Government on its plans so that organisations can indeed plan ahead. And my officials, as with Shona Robison, will continue to press for more financial clarity.
Question number three, Fergus Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Economic Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding support for any businesses impacted by the ban on wood-burning stoves in new-built homes.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Presiding Officer, while the Economy Secretary has had no meetings with colleagues on the topic, I do want to make clear that there is no ban on wood-burning stoves. Under the new build heat standard, wood-burning stoves can continue to be installed as emergency heating in new buildings. However, we acknowledge that stoves are often installed for more frequent use, and we are currently undertaking a review of the standard. This has involved both official and ministerial engagement with stove industry stakeholders. The Minister for Climate Action is overseeing the review and will update Parliament when it reaches its conclusions shortly.
Fergus Ewing.
Presiding Officer, as it happened some years ago, I purchased a wood stove from an excellent small business in Inverness, going by the name of Bonk and Co. That is Bonk and Co. Does the Minister agree with me that the failure to lift the ban on companies like Bonk and Co selling their stoves for new homes is utterly, wait for it, bonkers. And also a hangover from the Green Deal, which, like the wood stove contents, should surely now be no more than smouldering ashes.
Minister.
Well, can I commend Fergus Ewing for assiduously representing local businesses in his constituencies? And I would suggest that for new members elected in 2026 who are looking for some instruction in how to represent businesses in their constituency, we have no finer example to turn to than Mr Ewing. The points he raises is why we are undertaking this review. And as I've said, the Minister for Climate Action is overseeing this work and is leading on it and will, of course, report to Parliament in terms of providing an update. I, of course, as a minister within the economy portfolio, stand ready and willing to engage with any member of this Parliament on any concerns they may have with regards to how government regulation impacts upon business in their constituency.
And supplementary, Jamie Hocker-Johnson.
Thank you. In the consultation for its new Heat and Buildings Bill, the Scottish Government is proposing, and I quote, to introduce a new law which will require those purchasing a property to comply with a prohibition on polluting heating within a specified amount of time following the completion of the sale. I know Fergus Ewing's question related to the impact of the new build heat standard and the ban on wood burners in new build properties, but can the Minister assure me that his government isn't about to get itself into another mess trying to ban wood burners and other forms of direct heating from homes? And if it is, what analysis has it undertaken on the further economic impact this will have on businesses?
Minister.
Well, I would want to assure the member that with all legislation and all regulation, this government will be having the closest engagement with business and engaging in the closest analysis of all particular economic impacts that could arise locally or nationally. So I hope that provides some reassurance for the member, and I'd be more than happy to engage with him further if he wishes to discuss more.
Question number four, Patrick Harvey.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to implement the policy announced in March 2022 in regard to companies maintaining trade links with Russia following the invasion of Ukraine.
Deputy First Minister.
Well, in March 2022, we called on businesses in Scotland to sever their links with Russia. That policy reflects the specific circumstances of the full-scale invasion of Ukraine and is additional to the UK Government's regime of sanctions against Russia. We subsequently issued guidance for the Scottish Government and our economic agencies when entering into a significant relationship with companies. This sets out checks to undertake on companies to identify links with Russia and steps they have taken to withdraw from them, while recognising that severing links may not always be feasible in exceptional circumstances.
Patrick Harvey.
The Deputy First Minister may be aware of a Glasgow-based company, Seapeak, which has been the subject of reports by investigative journalists and which has continued to run vessels trading in Russian LNG. The fact that a firm based in Glasgow is continuing to prop up the Putin regime by trading in fossil fuels, regardless of either the invasion of Ukraine or the climate emergency, will shock and disgust many people. Yet there's currently no action being taken to shut down this extraordinarily unethical business. Will the Deputy First Minister write to the new Foreign Secretary highlighting this scandal and urging the UK Government to ensure that firms profiteering from a business that fuels climate change and helps fund Putin's illegal war are shut down?
Deputy First Minister.
As Patrick Harvey suggests, sanctions are a reserved matter, and we have made very clear what our views are in relation to Russia, and we expect businesses and organisations to reflect that that are operating in Scotland. We have called on the UK Government to put in place the strongest possible sanctions regime against Russia, and I will indeed write to the Foreign Secretary to make clear our position on these matters and to encourage them to continue to increase pressure on the Russian regime.
Question number five, Ruth McGuire.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what assessment it's made of the contribution that house building makes to the Scottish economy.
Deputy First Minister.
Well, our statistics estimate that in 2023, investment in dwellings, so that's both house building and repairs and maintenance, totaled around £6.9 billion, directly contributing 3.5% of GDP, and as set out in our long-term strategy, Housing to 2040, housing makes a crucial contribution to our vision of an economy that delivers sustainable and inclusive growth for the people of Scotland.
Ruth McGuire.
Thank the Deputy First Minister for that answer. As well as benefits to the wider economy, housing plays a critical role in the economic opportunity for individuals and their families. Impact quality housing has on health and education is also well understood. With that in mind, can I ask the Deputy First Minister to provide an update on the work of the Housing Investment Task Force and the actions being taken to unlock housing investment that will bring economic and social benefit to our communities?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I met with the Housing Minister just a matter of hours ago to discuss progress on the Housing Investment Task Force and to consider how we can work together to ensure that there is a flow of investment and homes are being built. We recognise that housing is one of the most pressing economic issues of our day, but it's also one of the biggest opportunities if we can support people to live in a warm, secure and affordable home. In the programme for government later today, Parliament will see the actions that we are taking that take account of some of the early outputs from the task force. The task force itself is due to report by the end of March 2025.
Supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. During the summer, I met with a number of developers who have highlighted the total collapse now in the mid-market rent sector in Scotland following its inclusion in the SNP Green Rent Controls policy. I'm sorry to say that these developers are saying Scotland is not open for business, and we are seeing these developments and investments going to the north of England. So can I ask the Deputy First Minister if the Scottish Government will now agree to remove mid-market rent developments from the rent controls so that we can make sure these homes are actually built?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, can I just briefly set the context that since 2007 we've supported the delivery of more than 131,000 affordable homes, with more than 93,000 of those being for social rent, and we will continue to build on that record with almost £600 million of investment in the Affordable Housing Supply Programme this year. We are focused on delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, and we have brought forward the review scheduled for 2026 to 2024 to concentrate on deliverability. I see an opportunity here to ensure that the regulatory framework allows us to deliver investment, to build homes and to ensure that everyone has access to secure and affordable housing. And we will work with investors as well as representatives of the housing market and critically tenants in order to get it right.
And supplementary, Karen Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. During the summer, I met with a number of workers within the house building industry, roofers, joiners and other trades workers. Young people and industry experts telling me the challenge they face finding training places, skilled workers and recruiting into industry. I met one young apprentice who required to travel to London to gain a qualification to allow him to work within his chosen trade, and this is not unusual. Given how important house building and indeed home improvement is to the Scottish economy, would the Deputy First Minister agree to encourage better cross-portfolio working to ensure the sector can bridge this gap in locally accessible training places? And would she consider meeting industry experts who do have some solutions to help with these skills gaps?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, in short, I am very happy to meet with, to work with businesses, organisations and workers that are helping to deliver our pipeline of housing. The skills that she references is relevant to housing, but is actually relevant to the wider construction industry. And we know how critical construction is to our overall economic performance, as well as to supporting some of the perhaps more deprived communities in Scotland, because through investment in infrastructure, we can regenerate different parts of Scotland. So there is a big opportunity here, which is a long way of saying I'm very happy to work with them.
Question number six, David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it has had with Harland & Wolff regarding any potential job losses at its yards in Methil, the Kirkcaldy constituency and Arnish on Isle of Ewes.
Minister Tom Martin.
The Scottish Government has held regular discussions with the management team and unions at Harland & Wolff. The Deputy First Minister spoke to the Executive Chairman on Monday, 2 September, and I visited the Methil site in July, when I was able to confirm our commitment to working with the company to secure the future for the vitally important jobs they provide at both sites.
David Torrance.
The workforce at both these Scottish yards are passionate, dedicated and highly skilled. In recent years, the Methil site has seen a resurgence in shipbuilding. In addition, it has continued its presence in the renewable sector. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my view that every avenue must be explored to safeguard the future of the site and assure that jobs and apprenticeship opportunities for future generations exist for many years to come?
Minister.
Yes, I do, and I can also assure David Torrance that the Scottish Government are engaging with the UK Government and the business, both at a senior and a local level. It is ultimately up to the management teams and investors within the business to work through the commercial options to provide a sustainable future for the organisation and the workforce. The business is fully aware of the interests from both governments, and the management are working closely with the UK and Scottish Governments.
And supplementary, Clare Baker.
Thank you very much. As Mr Torrance has recognised, the site at Methil has a highly skilled and committed workforce, and they are keen to contribute towards a just transition. I understand that the Methil and Arnish sites have progressed to Phase 2 of the Scottish Offshore Wind Energy Council strategic investment model. That's an important fund for supporting businesses who are going to help us realise a just transition. Can I ask when a decision on investment is going to be made, and does the Minister recognise the importance of a swift decision to protect jobs in Methil and support the Ard to secure contracts?
Minister.
I'm not in a position to confirm when the decision will be made, but I do recognise the points that the Member raises.
And question number 8, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the development of its green industrial strategy and its commitment to leverage up to £500 million over the next 5 years for Scotland's offshore wind supply chain.
Deputy First Minister.
Well, we will publish the green industrial strategy shortly. We're kick-starting our commitment to invest up to £500 million to anchor our offshore wind supply chain in Scotland with investment of £67 million in the sector this financial year. That supports market certainty, creating highly productive, competitive offshore wind sector, providing thousands of new jobs, embedding innovation, boosting skills, and we're working across the public sector to ensure that funding is delivered to the projects as quickly as possible, subject to rigorous due diligence and value for money assurance processes.
Liam MacArthur.
I thank the Deputy First Minister. Last year, the Floating Offshore Wind Task Force made clear that a minimum of 3 to 5 Scottish ports need to urgently be transformed into new industrial hubs to enable the required rollout of floating offshore wind. Without major downstream infrastructure investment in our offshore wind sector, there's little prospect of Scotland meeting our net zero goals or realising our energy potential. So, given the Finance Secretary's confirmation yesterday that ScotWind revenues will be diverted away from tackling the climate and biodiversity crises, can the Deputy First Minister provide a cast-iron assurance that the Government remains committed to that £500 million leveraging in over the next 5 years for the offshore wind sector, alongside a 10-year £500 million just transition fund?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I think the fact that we have already spent £67 million as part of that £500 million illustrates that we are serious about delivering this investment. We're taking a commercial-first approach to investment to leverage private funding in the infrastructure and manufacturing facilities critical to our world-leading offshore wind sector. And while investments are likely to have a specific geographical focus, perhaps even on Orkney, the wider economic value will benefit all of Scotland in the process.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on Deputy First Minister responsibilities, economy and Gaelic. And we'll be a very short pause before we move on to the next portfolio to allow members to change positions should they so wish. I mean, if they could do that quickly, that would be helpful. Thank you. The next portfolio is finance and local government. And again, if a member wishes to request a supplementary, they should do so by pressing the request to speak button during the relevant question. Question number one, I call Claire Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met with North Lanarkshire Council and what was discussed.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robson.
Scottish ministers and Scottish Government officials regularly meet representatives from all local authorities to discuss a range of issues of mutual interest.
Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Primary 1 to 5 pupils receive free school meals thanks to the Scottish Government investment. Labour North Lanarkshire reportedly charges one of the highest prices for school meals in the country for primary 6 and 7 pupils, and we know the extent of in-work poverty in that area. A family in my Motherwell and Wishaw constituency could be paying £170 a month or £1,615 a year. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what action can be taken to ensure that my constituents are able to access affordable school needs and meals amidst rising bills? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Scottish Government has made clear its commitment to supporting families and eradicating child poverty. We do have the most extensive provision of free school meals in the UK, and our free school meals programme is a key element to meeting these aims, and we continue to expand our programme with the next phase to families in receipt of Scottish Child Payment in primaries 6 and 7. I would note and say to Claire Adamson that North Lanarkshire Council does have general fund reserves of £250 million as of the 31st of March 2023, the latest available audited figures. And I think that has increased in the provisional outturn figures. So general fund reserves do need to be taken into account in terms of the decisions that local authorities make.
And supplementary, Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. North Lanarkshire Council have recently increased the distance at which secondary school pupils are eligible for school buses, with the rollout to primary schools proposed for next year. Many parents are concerned about the proposed walking routes heading into winter, with many poorly lit. The alternative given to parents was the public service buses, and my office have received several stories of these buses driving past groups of school children or being too crowded to allow any more on. The local authority are citing budget issues as one of the reasons for cutting the routes. Will the Cabinet Secretary meet with me to find a solution to ensure that financial decisions are not being put ahead of the well-being of children in North Lanarkshire?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, I would be more than happy to meet with Gillian Mackay. Obviously, the decisions that local authorities make are for them to make. But I would say, further to the information I gave to Claire Adamson about reserves, the general fund reserves per head of population, I think North Lanarkshire has now risen to the fourth highest at 31st of March of this year, with a provisional outturn of £747 per person in terms of the reserve position. As I said earlier, the position of reserves needs to be seen as part of each local authority's budget setting and decisions that they make around the priorities that they have locally.
Question number two, Liam Kerr.
Sir, to ask the Scottish Government how much funding it has allocated to local authorities whose housing stock and former housing stock requires demolition and rebuilding due to the presence of reinforced autoclaved aerated concrete.
Minister Ivan McKee.
It is the responsibility of building owners to maintain their properties and for each local authority to decide the appropriate action in relation to RAC identified, which primarily is a building maintenance concern. Although there is no new funding available to address this issue, where the local authority has decided that demolition is the best solution, we will work with them to explore flexibilities within current funding for them to consider. Local authorities manage their own budgets, but we are committed to working alongside them on this to ensure that they and any homeowners affected are supported appropriately.
Liam Kerr.
Well, underfunded Aberdeen City Council is pressing ahead with knocking down homes in Torry Balnagaska at a cost of £25 million. Reports suggest rebuilding could cost £130 million and take up to 15 years. And all the while, displaced residents who report this is causing them anxiety and despair just don't believe their homes will ever be rebuilt. Now, last week, the Scottish Government informed the Petitions Committee that affected households will see engagement in the coming weeks and months. So what has the Minister actually done to ensure Aberdeen City Council will have sufficient funds to rebuild and can do so sooner than 15 years?
Minister.
Well, I think the first point to note is that Aberdeen City Council have had an increase of an additional 5.4% on their budget, an extra £23.8 million to support day-to-day services. And it's also important to recognise that the previous UK government, the Conservative government, said that they would spend whatever it took to resolve the RAC issue, including funds coming to Scotland. And, of course, they did not deliver on any of that, which means that we are in the position that we find ourselves at the moment. But, of course, I've said we are very keen to work with any council that finds it itself in this position to explore what possibilities there are to work together to resolve this very serious issue for the homeowners concerned and to support the Council to deliver on that.
I have in fact received requests from four members. I would hope to take each of the four, but I would need cooperation to have brief questions. First supplementary, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have engaged with well over 100 constituents affected by RAT during what is one of the biggest housing crises Scotland has ever faced. And as council tenants move home, private homeowners, many with mortgages, face continued uncertainty. And regrettably, my repeated correspondence to the new UK government on funding has gone unanswered. The decision made by Aberdeen City Council to demolish and rebuild limits private homeowners' choices in how to proceed. Therefore, what options does the Scottish Government have to afford the Council the fiscal flexibilities to offer just and equitable funding support to affected homeowners?
Minister.
My ministerial colleague, the Minister for Housing and officials, have held constructive discussions with Aberdeen City Council throughout their options appraisal process for homes impacted by poor condition RAC. And as indicated in my earlier response to Mr Kerr, while there are no additional funds to allocate to this issue, we have supported the exploration of financial flexibility options for the Council to consider. Aberdeen City Council have not yet made a formal request for statutory flexibilities, but as soon as we receive this, we will give urgent consideration so that the Council may provide early assurance to those affected.
Supplementary, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's good to hear that the Scottish Government are committed to resolving some of the issues around RAC. We have seen the publication of the Grenfell report today, and we are 7 years on, and there only have been two buildings remediated since that tragic fire. Can I ask the Minister how long he expects residents affected by RAC to have to wait, and if he'd make a commitment that it would be less time than the 7 years that many residents affected by combustible cladding have had to wait?
Minister.
As I've indicated, we are working with my colleague, the Minister for Housing, whose portfolio this is working with local authorities across Scotland to understand the extent of this and to work with them where they come forward and make formal requests for flexibilities to be able to ensure that together we're able to support householders that are affected by RAC. And I'm sure that my colleague, the Minister for Housing, will give an update in due course as to progress being made on this very important issue.
Supplementary, Mark Ruscoe.
A group of residents in Tillicoultry were forced to move out of their homes over a year ago because of deteriorating RAC, but they still don't have access to their homes to collect personal belongings such as passports, and there are growing fears in the community that these properties are going to be broken into. Can I ask the Minister what guidance the Scottish Government is offering councils on residents who may need to re-enter their homes to retrieve essential items during the period where they are unable to live there?
Minister.
I recognise the issue that the member raises, and I know that this has happened in other situations where residents have had to move out very quickly of their premises, and I've seen it in Glasgow as well, of course, at short notice due to safety concerns. Clearly, there's a balance to be struck here between the safety of those residents who may want to enter those potentially very dangerous properties and their need to retrieve personal possessions and other important documents and so on. I will check with my ministerial colleagues what guidance there is available on this and respond to the member to make sure that he's aware of the current situation and the guidance that government has put in place to deal with those particular situations.
And supplementary, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This concrete isn't just in domestic dwellings, it is in public buildings as well. It's in hospitals, schools, libraries. It's now 18 months since I first brought this crisis to the attention of the government in this chamber, and we're just concluding the identification stage. So is the government now confident it knows where this concrete is in every building in the public estate? And secondly, is it going to extend capital funding to organisations like NHS Scotland to make sure that our patients are safe in the hospitals where they are?
Minister.
Well, clearly the requirement for funding will be part of ongoing budget discussions with my colleague, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, as at the appropriate time, once we're aware of the impact of RAC. But as the member will be aware, surveys have been undertaken across the public estate to assess the prevalence of RAC, but more also as part of that, not just whether RAC exists, but the condition of that RAC and the criticality of the structural issues round about that. And with that information, we're proceeding to address that issue across the public estate.
Question number three, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government, in line with the agreed procedure, whether it will provide the Scottish Fiscal Commission with a public sector pay policy ahead of its budget for 2025-26.
Cabinet Secretary.
There is an established protocol between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Fiscal Commission which sets out the information sharing expected to take place in the lead-up to the Scottish Budget. We will continue to engage and work collaboratively with the Commission on matters relating to public sector pay and workforce, and will strive to provide timely information related to pay in the lead-up to future fiscal events.
Michael Mara.
Well, I'd be very glad if the Finance Secretary would actually honour the protocol that was set out in October 2022. For the last 2 years, she has failed to do so. She told me in committee on 16th of January that it would not be right, I quote, to provide that policy. She may well noted the chair of the Scottish Fiscal Commission in front of committee yesterday saying that this policy should be provided. Given the debacle of her cuts yesterday due to the incompetence partly around public sector pay, can she commit now to producing that policy to the Commission ahead of the budget?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, in the letter to Michael Mara on the 15th of January, the reason that I said we would have to wait to set out public sector pay policy was that there was going to be a UK spring budget following the budget in the autumn, which would provide an update on the fiscal outlook and on the UK government's public spending policy that could impact on devolved funding envelopes. So the problem here for Michael Mara is the exact problem that Daniel Johnson, who I've got a lot of respect for, but got himself tied up in knots on Good Morning Scotland this morning when he tried to distinguish the impact of Tory cuts in Wales and the impact on the Welsh Labour government having to bring forward an emergency budget, and as distinct from having no fault whatsoever when it comes to Scotland. So the Tories at fault when it comes to Wales, the Tories not at fault when it comes to Scottish public finances. It was excruciating to listen to, and Labour really have to come clean in their analysis of the situation. So we will continue to work with the Scottish Fiscal Commission. We will continue to make sure that pay policy is affordable, sustainable, and we will take that forward.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Supplementary, Elizabeth.
Cabinet Secretary, Professor Roy did say yesterday that this lack of information is a very serious matter. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that when it comes to parliamentary scrutiny, it would be far preferable if we did have that information to hand?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can say to Liz Smith, absolutely, but I'm sure Liz Smith will also recognise that when you have a spring budget emerging straight after the budget we've just set and then not knowing what the funding envelope is going to be for pay, then of course I needed to wait to see what that funding envelope was going to be. And of course that is absolutely critical. We can only set a pay policy that we can afford, and I have set out in great detail as to why the pay policy was set as it was. And of course, as I said at the time, anything beyond the pay policy would need to either be funded by more UK government funding or through cuts. That is the simple reality of the situation. So we will continue to work with SFC, we'll continue to work with the Finance Committee, but let's be absolutely clear that the Scottish Government's finances will be dictated in large part by what comes at the budget on the 30th of October.
Question number four, Major Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recently published government expenditure and revenue figures, which reportedly show a £2,400 dividend in the last year for every person in Scotland as a result of its continued membership of the United Kingdom.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, firstly, we know that 90% of the GERS deficit is due to UK government choices. Secondly, we know that the UK government retains control of 40% of expenditure and over 70% of revenues in Scotland. That is set out in the GERS report. As an example, a significant portion of the spending allocated to Scotland relates to servicing UK government debt, which is paid at a higher rate than our European neighbours. So the Scottish Government is required to balance its budget each year, and does so, and has always presented a balanced budget to Parliament. And in doing so, the Scottish Government has taken difficult decisions on revenue and expenditure in order to target the support to those in the greatest need, such as the Scottish Child Payment.
Martin Fraser.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. Yesterday, when she was announcing the savage cuts she's making to public spending across Scotland thanks to SNP financial mismanagement, she incredibly claimed that separation would make things better. Given that our own government's figures show the complete opposite, that there would be a massive fiscal deficit of nearly £23 billion, how could she do that with a straight face?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as the Treasury have just pointed out in the last few weeks, the Treasury, which I am assuming Murdo Fraser will accept this figure, the deficit is on UK governments, his government, the Tory government, not resetting budgets due to inflationary pressures. That took £15 billion out of public funding, £15 billion. So we'll take no lectures from the Tories about financial management when they took £15 billion out of public services by not resetting budget with inflation, and of course £22 billion of a black hole, which of course the Labour Chancellor has outlined, which of course will impact on Scotland if the Labour government continues to follow Tory fiscal rules. And of course they're quite chummy today, so I'm sure unfortunately that's what Scotland will experience going forward.
Question number 5, Maurice Golden.
To ask the Scottish Government how it intends to fund pay increases for local government employees.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government has taken extraordinary decisions to provide £77.5 million to support a fair pay offer for local government workers. This is a better offer than made in the rest of the UK, and most will see a rise of more than 4%. This is at the absolute limit of affordability, and as set out to Parliament yesterday, we're taking action across all portfolios to balance our budget, and this is made more difficult by the Chancellor's decision not to fully fund pay deals and a lack of clarity on funding ahead of the UK Government's budget.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Last week we learned the SNP were diverting £5 million from nature restoration to fund pay awards. Earlier this week, Unison members voted to reject the latest offer from COSLA. Given the Cabinet Secretary has also now slashed £23.4 million from the net zero and energy budget, will she rule out diverting any more funds from climate and nature projects?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, we didn't want to have to make any of the decisions that we've had to make, but in order to resolve some of the pay disputes and to support public pay expenditure on pay, then we've had to take some of these very difficult decisions. Of course, the nature restoration budget that Maurice Golden referred to will be restored in 25-26. We made that commitment. But of course, I'm sure Maurice Golden will want to welcome the fact that the GMB, of course, have accepted the pay deal. We'll hear what Unite have to say tomorrow. The EIS have accepted the position for teachers, which again is something to be welcomed. We would urge COSLA to continue to discuss with Unison the position that they have, because they are, at the end of the day, the employers, and we would urge them to do so. What we don't want to see is further damaging industrial action, and that is why we have gone above and beyond in order to help with the envelope that COSLA could offer to a local government workforce. It's also worth bearing in mind, presiding officer, that there is no additional funding coming from the UK government for the local government workforce apart from teachers, and that is regrettable.
Thank you, Brief supplementary, David Torrance.
Thank you, presiding officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary, like me, welcome the GMB members have agreed overwhelmingly to support fair pay offer made, and does she share my disappointment that Unison members have voted to reject it? Hopefully Unite members will vote to accept it and agreement can be reached with Unison. Can she advise how the pay offer and levels for Scottish local government employees compare with other parts of the UK?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I am pleased that over three quarters of GMB Scotland members agreed that this is a fair pay offer and voted to accept it. The pay award offered in Scotland is, as I said earlier, better than that made to local government workers across the rest of the UK. More than 60% of workers would receive an increase of more than 4%, and importantly, the lowest paid workers, including Unison members, would receive an increase of 5.63%. I think that is a fair offer for all, and the Scottish Government will continue to work constructively with COSLA as efforts continue to secure a deal and avert industrial action, which, as I said, is in no one's interest.
Question number 6 is not lodged. Question number 7, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions the Finance Secretary has had with the UK Government regarding public spending in light of the Prime Minister's remarks that the Labour Administration's first budget is going to be painful.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the First Minister and I met the Chancellor of the Exchequer last week and we discussed collaboration between the Scottish and UK governments, but also pressed the Chancellor on the need for public investment across the UK to protect public services, to tackle poverty and to grow the economy. The Prime Minister's remarks about the next UK government, the UK budget rather, are deeply concerning, as this, as I said earlier, will absolutely directly impact on our funding. I set out yesterday the difficult decisions we're already taking on the challenges facing the Scottish budget, and as the Chancellor looks to her first budget, it's vital that public services and vulnerable people are protected and that we don't have further austerity impacting on public services here in Scotland.
Colette Stevenson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. After 14 years of Tory austerity, the Labour Party in Westminster is intensifying the worst of what we saw under the likes of David Cameron and Boris Johnson. My apologies. Labour's pledge to keep Tory fiscal rules is a huge factor in the £22 billion of cuts they are now choosing to make. Labour promised change, but they are delivering the same old failed Westminster economic agenda. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the UK Labour government must see sense, invest in public services, reverse the cuts to Scotland's capital budget,
thank you, Ms. Stevenson.
And scrap
Cabinet
the
Secretary.
Current policy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Colette Stevenson for her question? So the Chancellor absolutely has a choice to make in her forthcoming budget. She can continue with Tory fiscal rules and Tory austerity, or she can change course and invest in public services. Increased funding for infrastructure and public services will be absolutely required if we want to take the action to lift children out of poverty, including, of course, things that the Labour Chancellor could also do to help that, like ending the damaging two-child limit. So there is a political choice here, and Labour in this Parliament cannot escape the reality that Labour austerity looks and feels to public services exactly the same as Tory austerity does. That is a political choice, and they will be held to account for whatever choice they make.
And question number 8, Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of its reported decisions to instruct local authorities to divert money from the Nature Restoration Fund towards local government pay settlements, what discussions the Finance Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding action that can be taken to mitigate any impact of this decision on projects aimed at reversing nature loss.
Cabinet Secretary.
So within an extremely challenging financial context, the Scottish Government has made difficult decisions in order to deliver fair pay deals and to avoid industrial action across the public sector. Protecting and restoring our natural environment is key to addressing the twin crises of nature loss and climate change. More than £50 million has already been distributed through the Nature Restoration Fund since 2021. And while capital funding of £5 million from this year's Nature Restoration Fund has been redirected within local authorities to fund the pay offer, as I said earlier, it has been agreed between ministers that it will be replaced in 2025-26.
Arianne Burgess.
The Nature Restoration Fund has created jobs right across Scotland and brought benefits to local communities, their economies and environments. The Greens are fully in favour of fair deals for council workers. But instead of dipping into funding that benefits communities, the Scottish Government could cut back on subsidies and tax cuts to big businesses like Shell, Ineos and Acorn Partners, who continue to receive millions in public funds whilst raking in record profits for climate-wrecking fossil fuels. Will the Scottish Government reconsider, retain nature funding and accelerate reform of Scotland's outdated council funding so councils can deliver for nature and for workers?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, on that last point, can I say to Arianne Burgess that we do want to make progress on council funding and the way that local taxation works. And I chair the joint group with COSLA that is aiming to do just that. And the progress has been made around things like second homes and empty homes. But the point about the Fair Pay Deal and the Nature Restoration Fund is that it had to be funding that was available now in year. So the ideas and issues that Arianne Burgess raised would not release that funding in year to be able to support the pay deal in the here and now, and that had to be done. So these choices are difficult, but they were the only ones available in order to make that pay envelope bigger to be able to make that offer. So as I say, that money will be restored in 25-26 because we do recognise the importance of that, and I hope that's something that Arianne Burgess will support.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the portfolio questions on finance and local government. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.